here towards the jungler. They want to make sure Broken Shard does not have a good game. It probably felt the chaos in the laning phase there for Complexity, with Broken Shard not really being able to be as present as usual.
These are the exact same bans as game one. And we're going to have to see if that last one comes in and it's exactly the same. Because they took away Ziggs, took away Xin Zhao, took away Kha'Zix. Broken Shard probably make sure he doesn't get going. Then the Ryze, which means that they probably want to first pick a Renekton here for Rux. Just take that away. Because if it ends up... Nope. Okay. So K1 Pro, he's actually going to get his baby again, the Thresh. Well, so they might pick Renekton for themselves now for Complexity Black. That's always the thing. You have to be like, what's my tier list? What's my number one pick? And then is that what we're going to form the team composition around? Or do we not want to show too much at once? So now it's Complexity Black's turn to pick that up. And I didn't know that K1 Pro was just a Thresh main.
Enough to take it first and say we're not showing you what we have right now for anything. Keeping your hands that clean coming into game two is actually, I think, a really nice thing to have. Because then the other team's wondering, they say, well, if we go too far one way, Thresh can be in a composition that does whatever they want. They can go shields, they can't go Nidalee, I guess. But they can still go a little bit of poke with what they find. So
yeah, there's
Academy.
There's like a thread every day about how powerful Thresh is just because of his innate kit. And people always say if he did no damage, he would still be a top support just because his kit has so much pressure, CC, hard, soft, and displacement. So
I was actually going to say maybe Duosec will take LeBlanc. He did previously. Games versus LMQ, he's played that. But West Rice grabbing that up right there for Prowly. Definitely a champion that Prowly can carry on, as Dominate was saying. Kind of needs to be the guy to really get going. We saw West Rice have a great game on Jax. He was dictating. He was taking top turrets by himself, but wasn't a big enough player to snowball the game all by himself. So hopefully Prowly can get in that position.
And they picked the LeBlanc and the Morgana. Morgana is regarded as one of the hardest counters to Thresh because all of his moves are very telegraphed.
Yeah.
You see the hook wind up. You're like, I'm in range of Flay, Black Shield myself. Box comes down, you can walk through multiple walls and you'll be fine. Doesn't slow you, doesn't do anything to you. Just race right
just
through
knocking
it.
Knocking down doors.
Yeah, he did it before too, but not to the same effect.
The house record counter.
All of those hooks from K1 Pro were right on target, and the Black Shields were not from Bubba Dub. So we're going to have to see if he can step up his game and actually lock them up. But now, the Renekton and the Lee Sin, once again, both go over to Curse Academy. This is the same composition here from Curse Academy. Same bands, same comp. Might be a repeat in terms of picks, just swapping sides.
Right. We see that Elise coming out as well instead of the Eve this time. It'll be very interesting to see if Complexity Black gets everything they had. Kale's being taken out by Duosec once again. So, tried and true, they're running it.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
I guess so.
That's exactly what they're doing right now. They're saying, well, it worked last game and we did so well. And Mash, hovering over the Vayne.
Oh, man.
We've seen him play Vayne before. He's a very good player in terms of mechanics. He's very mechanically sound. He loves Vayne. He loves those late game carries because he can deliver consistently. He will consistently farm well regardless of the range on his champion. He will be left the farm in a split push lane. We saw it with him on the Twitch. And if he's Vayne, he can do that again and be like, if anybody comes up to me, that's fine. But he goes with the Caitlyn instead. And that's the only swap here from Curse Academy's team composition.
Kind of like the pickup as well.
It works well against Lucian.
To spray and pray against this team in general, they're all just going to kind of dash out of it during the fight. It's going to be hard to keep track of any whole line of people looking at what you have right here. So I like the Caitlyn pickup. Also takes that. Robert X Lee is playing Lucian, but still Robert X Lee is not playing on his most comfortable AD carry right there. So, although Lucian is probably like that far behind.
Yeah, it's
Caitlyn.
Right behind it.
It's a little bit. That's the thing they were talking about, though. All the comfort. If you can get all the comfort, then they're going to be better off. And Curse Academy is just out of Twitch this game. That's it. And it was their choice.
Yeah, that's the only difference here for them. They go with the Caitlyn for the range and to stay even with Lucian in lane.
Right.
Because they may get the 2v2, they may get the 2v1, but they're preparing for it either way. So now they're probably just going to send Caitlyn bottom, because she does really well in 2v2. She does really well in 2v1s. And if Complexity Black want to be the ones to initiate on the turret top that has that extra bonus against auto attacks, then Curse Academy's fine with that. That's what that's telling me right there. Because Caitlyn means I look to lane. I'm not looking to split push.
Right.
Because the Twitch is like, that means I want a 2v1. Because Lucian versus Twitch is not a good matchup for Twitch. Lucian versus Vayne.
Kind of hurts.
Still not a good matchup. You can tumble out of Piercing Lights, but that's not the most of his damage in the early game anyway.
I mean, Lucian versus Caitlyn is still like an okay. Yeah. It's still annoying.
They're both lane bullies.
So annoying to play against. All the Qs just flying over.
And Vayne is one of the champions in the game that only has single target abilities. You cannot push a wave. None of her abilities are AoE.
That's true.
I think it's like her, Poppy, and that's it.
We could buy a team out of Poppy.
Yeah. that's an item, though. You could buy, you know.
Can't buy a team out on Vayne.
You could buy Runans, though. You could buy Hurricane.
Knocking things down.
Static Shiv, that's fine.
This is true, you can.
Static Shiv is actually a viable build on her, though. Don't build Rune Ants on her.
Why not? The money sink of
That'd be great if you could put Silver Bolts on three people.
Yeah.
It'd be ridiculous.
That would be pretty nice. So we'll see this game coming in. Curse Academy looks to grab the second game in the Best of Five series. Complexity Black looking top shape as well. That game went really to the top.
Yeah,
it bar was reached by both teams, and then finally Curse Academy kind of just stretched out and was able to get the strip of the last first place. So we'll see what they can get now coming into the second game. It's still the comfort picks for both teams, I would say. Complexity Black looks like they got what they want. They were just hovering on things, taking their time, making sure they're realizing what happened last game. Because in a best of three series, you definitely have to go competition brain and say, that game's over. Let's just go to the next game, whatever. They're each a best of one. Let's win. Let's just win.
Yeah.
Because that can really help sometimes, especially in these tense moments. It's going to have to be for both of these teams right now. Curse Academy seeming to prevail a little bit in that structure in the first game. We'll see what Complexity Black did in the team powwow here over the break.
And now, we already touched on what Curse Academy's team composition does in game one. So I don't really want to touch on it too much here because it's just Caitlyn that's being subbed in.
Yep, right.
And Complexity Black, they're probably going to do the buddy system again. They have the teleport advantage on Westrice. Also, Elise pushes turrets really well with Skittering Frenzy and Spiderlings. Mm-hmm. And the fact that they have a Lucian, who's really good at pushing turrets. If you use an ability, he'll just double shot it. It's fine. Probably, on the other hand, this is a skill matchup. Kale, it starts with a K sound. Kale versus LeBlanc is basically, can LeBlanc silence me and burst me before I'm able to use intervention and then turn it around? Because LeBlanc will try to poke you, dibble you down to about 30%, 40%, and then try to burst you. And if he's successful with that, then it'll be in Crawley's favor. But if Duoset can turn it around, which we know Kale's his little baby, tip that lane.
That's only a little helpful for Pat that Broken Shard walked back into the team with Vision. It's like, wait a minute. Oh, sorry, guys. Everybody's here. So they have a little bit of knowledge, but three members only tips off what they're going to be starting on. It doesn't really say that anybody else is diving in somewhere else.
Well, it does signal that he is adamant on starting at his red buff, which means he'll go red-blue bottom lane.
Right.
Which sets him up to go straight there. Jax is with him, and now they're going to put the AD carry and the support in the mid lane again and see where they go. But here, all five of them grouped up here. Rux is nowhere in the vicinity, but there are pings from Duosec, and they see it.
Duosec just sees the conga line coming in. Peacemaker going over about 200 damage. They're getting some nice hits in here, peppering down the health bars of Complexity Black, which they are forced to walk out on. Bub-dub. Bub-dub with the Tormented Soil of Forever. Can he steal it? I don't know if he's really going to try this. This would be crazy. What is he doing? Did he take Dark Binding? The Tormented Soil?
He hasn't taken anything just
yet. He hasn't taken anything. Yeah, looking at the bottom. He's just hovering.
So Rux is free farming. He's pushing that all the way to the turret as fast as he can. So even if he does get 2v1, then he's got experience. He'll be level 2. And that doesn't set him up for a great situation. But they want to go for the 2-on-2 in the top lane. That's the Lucian pick coming up. You want to be a lane bully.
Ooh.
And Morgana does really well versus Thresh in lane.
And we just saw Rux hit level 2 in the bottom. Westrice going to have a little bit of trouble until he's pushed back to his turret. Then he'll be eating out the slice and dice. Broken Shard getting his red just now. That was actually quite a long time. He's going to be heading down with the blue on, or rather with the ward on his blue. He'll be able to get that quite safely. And like you said, we'll be in the bottom lane. But both junglers could match up on this Cyrene. Could get pretty bloody early.
Man, Renekton has that early game advantage versus Jax. He's trying to play it safe. He's down 8 CS. Just trying to get himself back up. Broken Shard will take this and start getting that mana back. And then we'll have to see where it goes from there. Because Lee Sin versus Lee Sin, it's kind of like, if he cues a Spiderling, then you're good. If he cues you, then you're most likely going to lose the trade.
Pushing Robert actually back to the turret. Very nice grab by K1 Pro. Missing a few CS. He's able to grab those. Very nice CSing, actually. Keeping it consistent. He is down, though. So this push from Mashmi and K1 Pro.
Oh, he had turret aggro there.
Yeah.
For just a second.
Yeah. That was very close. Bubba Dub is trying to play that edge of life and love. And there's a little bit of love with that one as well. Oh.
Just off of the shoulder.
Everybody's dodging, just hitting, just missing. Looks like we could actually get a good 2v2 here. Pat looking to get around the Spiderlings. Just missing the Sonic Wave. Spiderlings cutting off the pie, so we couldn't hit Prowly either. Really back and forth right here. So knowledge of the jungler is going to slow things down a little bit, unless they make the crazy move to go in for the jungle hit once again. But Prowly, very nice consistent damage staying just out of range of the turret.
Didn't use his W there, his distortion.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, there's a heal available for both of them.
Robert, don't run in.
Oh, they went for Broken Shard.
Oh, Broken Shard comes out of nowhere. Robert still taking a little bit of damage. They throw down the summoner heal that he gets himself in a range with. Another Peacemaker brings him an inch from death again, but he lives it out, and it's going to be Mash that goes down first. Valiant attempt coming in for Curse Academy. Now Westrice on the bottom side finds Pat as he tries to get some gold on the other side of the map for the team. Westrice is going to leap away from that one. And Rux, good guy, tanking the turret out so Pat gets a safety.
Oh,
whiffed it in front of Westrice. So close to hitting that one.
All of these Sonic Waves are so close to hitting. Just barely. And then the top lane gank tipped off that Pat needs to go bottom now.
Yeah.
Goes for it. He doesn't get rewarded for his efforts. Just a little bit of CS here for Rux. So he's winning the lane in the overall, but in the top, not so lucky for Mashmi this game. They're trying to shut him down.
Rux with the same exact build coming in, but first a pink ward for himself instantly as he goes down to the bottom lane. Feels like he can control that quite a bit. So why not buy a pink if it's going to be there for a while?
Oh, Prowly.
Man. A one,
he doesn't
two,
have his W.
Advantage.
Again.
That's all right. It was a good dodge.
It was a dodge.
Prowly read that. Right when you're on the edge of that and you're going to start running parallel along it is usually when somebody will attack. So you just kind of stutter step. It's almost always readable. They can't do anything else because they're going to be under the turret. So Prowly's got it. Yeah. Keeps it in mind.
I like the angle of the Sonic Wave too.
Yeah.
Because if he just gone straight, there's nowhere for him to dodge.
Exactly.
It's between him and the wall.
That's always a scary thing. When you're running from skill shots, stay away from a wall because it makes it that much easier to hit.
Unless you're going
to
go over it. That's about it.
Then you're free and clear.
Oh, see, four men strong again.
Very strong in the bottom lane here for Complexity Black. They're trying to dictate the turret takedown, and they're going to get this quite nicely. Like you said, with that Frenzy, instead of having the Evelyn, and now they're on the unarmored champion damage turret. So.
Yep, and it's still 6 minutes, so that top lane has that buff still.
We're not unarmored, sorry. Champion reduction.
Yeah, it's just a flat amount.
Easy to just say incorrectly every time.
It's got extra defenses.
We'll see now, Complexity Black. This is what Dominate said. It's really who wants to pull back off of the turret. And right now, looks like nobody is catering to that. They're going to go ahead and take the second one. Top lane still being pushed in. They have the Caitlyn. That's going to be nice for the pushes. Both sides on Lucian as well. So there should be too bad on this one, but look how much more they have to go. This is time that is going to be bought for Broken Shard to clear out the jungle. Dragon now to get pressure with Vision. These guys can do anything they want with all the Vision they have of Curse Academy in the top lane.
And the reason that Westrice doesn't TP up to the top is because they think that he can get there in time, but he can't. And now he has TP available for the Dragon fight, and there's two members up top from Curse Academy, so this is most likely an uncontested Dragon. Save for a Pat Q.
Yes, save for a Pat Q. We saw this last time. Robert X. Lee playing human
now
shield.
He's got a body block.
He's it's just like, no. Sonic Wave, no.
No.
He's trying to thread it. He's trying to thread it.
He can still safeguard. He can still safeguard to it.
Can he? Oh, they stopped attack.
Oh! Yeah.
Smart play from Complexity Black to completely turn
the he smited it early!
He gets it! Broken Shard smited early. Pat's going to get hipped up by the Dark Binding, but still a valiant attempt and a double thumbs up coming from his team on another Dragon Steal. Deja vu.
I'm still processing that.
Man.
Because he used his Q. Maybe he's just not used to the Elise, the new damage on it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's kind of a force of habit. You're like, all right, it's at this HP. My smite does this much.
Yeah.
Go ahead and use my bite. But no, was just short of it. And Pat just looks back, goes, oh, it's in smite range. Takes it for himself.
And this is, you know, a little bit of what happened last game. Complexity Black with an early lead. The first dragon was stolen away.
Oh, he right to the hook.
Academy. Ooh, that was big. Very, very close.
if the hook had landed long enough for his W to his distortion, the origin point to fade away, he would have been done for. Would have had to flash. And Rux, he's taking a lot of damage.
Just should be all right. Throws on that Dominus. He does have the stun up. He's trying to bait it in. He's saying, yeah, fight me. He did just use his Ignite, though, so they went hard in this fight. But he still feels like his Call of the Meek is going to give him enough back, and then he'll be able to stun him up. Now the fight to the mid lane.
Got himself back up.
Yeah.
Now they're just pushing. It's four men strong from Curse Academy in the mid lane. Oh, no black shield for that.
That is a dead Bubba Dub. Probably tries to go in and get the same amount of damage, but he comes up just short, unfortunately. DualSec able to get that heal and speed steroid in. Robert X Lee could get a nice side strafe culling, but it's going to be too little, too late. Cannot get any damage onto the team.
Yeah. It's unfortunate the levels here for him, too. Just sitting at five.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, no culling. Good call.
Yeah, there's no ace in the hole either. It's like you feel like it would be everybody would be six by now.
Absolutely.
But it's just this hyper accelerated game where everybody's like, we're not going to stay in lane for a long time. Because you see turrets drop and you're like, oh, it's mid game. Yeah. That's what my brain does.
That's what Complexity Black versus Red was, though. It was like 4 minute mid game. These guys had inhibitor turrets naked by that 5 minute mark. So I wouldn't be surprised.
And I was like, all right.
Just wanted to break lane.
Everybody's level 13, right? No, that's 4 minutes in. It's 422.
So probably cleaning up the mid lane here, has the blue buff, and he fights to break out. He will be more than happy to continue distorting on people's faces. 10.5 minutes into this one, K1 Pro trying to grab back a little bit of the jungle and goes ahead. He just waltzes by a pink ward. Why not?
And
smells like roses. Keep it there.
It's just a little flower for everybody. And on the point that it's a low experience game,
yeah,
because it's a low CS game
too.
Nobody's broken 70. Very
like
close for Mash too. Yeah, almost 11 minutes here. Mm-hmm. Where typically you'll see some people around the 80 mark,
right,
depending
on
how well they've been doing. But it's just been lane, just running around the map, testing Dragon very early, pushing up waves. And at that point, you don't really care about your CS and CSing under the turret. You care about getting the turret down. You don't care if the minions kill it, because you want it as fast as possible.
Right, you want the same influx of gold as everybody else is getting.
Yeah.
If you fall behind, and things get a little sticky. Right now, 200 gold, not too bad. That was actually about 300 or 400 quickly for Complexity Black. But Curse able to stave that off, like we said. Another Dragon steal. Not another one in this game, but just one after the other from first game to the second one. Pat has been on point. Probably, it's a nice chain down. Should be able to get some follow-up damage.
Oh,
the rest
intervention.
Of the team. How many flashes there were just used to get in? Okay, so it's just Broken Shard and then flashy moves from everybody else.
Intervention used to absorb a lot of damage. A lot of the burst came down at that moment.
Yeah.
They thought they had him locked up. They held off on it for a second, but K1 Pro, here comes Brawly.
Whoa, very nicely played. Broken Shard saying, we'll do this, I'll repel the aggro. And Brawly coming up with a very nice kill for himself. K1 Pro and Pat now to stand tall at the middle turret.
Ooh.
They look, they were already able to drop Complexity
Blast. Oh, West Rice.
Oh, dear. He's just out of the
range. He has his ward available.
Chugging the potions. Whew. I like it, because you're going to cut the Fog of War off as well with that jump just around the corner.
Dice. Nope.
Not enough. The minion wave, when just you think it can help you, it's going to be the thing that kills you.
Especially if he's against Renekton and Yasuo.
Yeah, right.
Like, I'm safe. Nope. Goes all the way through it.
Oh, getting the flash out. A lot of plays trying to be made right now, Zyrene. A lot of plays. Oh, the clone takes the damage, but it's not going to be enough. Rux has even more. Throws down the Tiamat damage as well as the Nest Slice and Dice Culling. Man, a lot is being put onto these pursuits here for each champion. Brawly getting taken down there. Westrice just had a coast-to-coast fight with Rux. Different game here. Everybody's kind of finding their own 1v1 fight around the map, or 2v2.
And the hook coming in onto Westrice. These black shields are late.
Or a 5v1, but Westrice, can't say it right, with a nice jump. And they're able to get out safely there. Pat getting a shot onto Bubba Dub. Doesn't decide to follow that in, but you can see Bubba Dub as well trying to support like heck, has just used flash.
Oh, here comes Robert
and
from the front.
This is what he wanted last time. There's the culling, but he realizes that the train is not stopping as it comes down the tracks. Tries to reposition himself. Broken Shard, not in the right spot. Mashmi can't get the last shot off.
Oh, he's in range of Mash. What are you doing?
Walked back in right to the auto attack. And it looks like Mash feels he can take a little bit of an assertive approach here. Puts himself up in the front of the fight with Duosec. Duo's like, I don't have much mana. Be careful what you do. Let's just clear the wave and take a breather.
I'm baffled at a lot of the play here from Complexity Black. The Morgana shields are very late. There was the point where Bubba Dove flashed. I don't know if it was up or not for himself. But at that point, it's kind of like just Black Shield the hook is why you pick Morgana into Thresh. And right there, Broken Shard overextended. They had a ward. They saw Mashmi go down. And they knew that Mashmi could see him, too.
Yeah.
The 650 range of Caitlyn is nothing to toy around with. And the fact that he also had Ace in the Hole available... I'm not sure.
Trying to go for those outplay moments, and you really just get in your own head trying to make
outplay
it happen.
Outplay yourself.
Sometimes being that low health bait can win your team the fight.
That's true.
But Curse isn't having any of that. They're not tunneling on these fights. They know what needs to be done. Albeit, it's great to try and get these cheeky moves in, but not when it starts to cost you. Now a 2,000 gold lead quickly being picked up here by Curse Academy. With that dragon, they stay on top of the objective. Westrice trying to do what he can to return that gold in the top lane.
That's exactly what he needs to do, the 2K gold lead here. The dragons falling into Curse Academy all game long. They've gotten both. You would think that Complexity Black got that first one, but no, the smite was not on point, but Pat was.
Yeah.
All game long. Game one, too. He's also been just in the right place at the right time, making the right moves. We're going to have to see if Mashmi... Now, I don't know if he's going to be the carry this game that he was last game.
Right.
But, man, is all of Curse Academy doing well.
Playing very well and avoiding what they said they wanted to avoid. Broken Shard himself said, I will be looking for Mashmi. I know he can carry the team. With the way the lanes have gone, you don't get a chance to gank the AD carry. You don't get a chance to gank Mashmi as much as you want. He's in safety right after the lanes are broken. So with what they want to do, they got to kind of change the direction they're going for. Because it's not going to happen like it regularly does out of the laning phase. Finding Mashmi is going to be hard. Still picking up CS for themselves in their own jungle. Both teams actually trying to soak up what's left. Get the last bit of levels and items they can before they meet face-to-face for another fight. Nashor's finished up onto Duosec. Deathfire Grasp as well on the other side. There's definitely a chance for Prolly to zero somebody out before intervention can be used.
Yeah, the DFG hopefully coming to a big form.
Yeah.
We'll see what he adds on the back of that. But the Nashor's Tooth, just the sustained damage from Duosec. The fact that it has some CDR too. It's going to be great for his intervention. But now Rux, he's looking for Westrice again. It's that level 10 point.
Walking into the brush, that was Westrice getting the upper hand on damage. You see Westrice loving this fight so far. Dives back in. Rux very low on this one, but he gets the ignite
down. Pat
is coming down from the end. And even without a ward there, Rux's positioning and behavior in the fight.
Ace in the hole.
There's a jump to the minions again. No!
Oh,
the minions!
So close!
Almost killing him again. Westrice gets to safety. Very, very coast-to-coast fights, like we've been saying, Curse Academy. But with that focus, doesn't put themselves in a bad spot. They get a minion wave right where they want it. And they also have vision on Prolly. Wherever Curse Academy comes from, they leave a trail of wards for safety.
And Broken Shard and Prolly both went to that bottom lane area, were cut off, and left Robert and Bubba Dove to deal with Duosec, but his wave clear was just too strong, and they couldn't even make it to this middle turret. Mm. Giving up one for nothing on that, in terms of turrets.
Still a very close game in CS. Both mids sitting at 106 right now, but those two kills for Prolly, we know that Prolly can be the one to carry, and he's going to be looking to do so. With the team right now playing the buddy system, looks like they're trying to get a few Fog of War picks here for themselves. Pink wards. Ooh, if he knew, I think he would have tried it, but he didn't.
Yeah, they sweep it out, but they don't do anything with it.
Yeah.
Had an itching that probably was in that bush. And now Westrice with the TP hasn't been able to make too much use of it this game. They've been shutting him down, going for him, the source of the teleport, as opposed to the rest of the team, and then just leaving Duosec to clean the wave out, and it's been working for them too.
Very good wave for Robert. You can see a full push on this. No freezing for him, but that also means that Complexity Black, with knowledge, the Curse is in farm mode right now, and if Curse wants to try and get a fight, they know Complexity is without that DPS of Robert so far has the Bloodthirster. Looks like he's actually focusing straight into a Last Whisper instead of getting that Triforce in there. Maybe he, just with the Goldie backed at around 800, was able to buy the pickaxe and still go for the Sheen next.
And even with the Lich Bane taking a little bit of a hit in terms of late game,
yeah,
it's still pretty good early.
See it two games.
It's better early now because it's based off of your percent of your base. Buying it early is more effective.
Yep.
Doesn't just scale as much. So he'll be good at taking turrets. He'll be good at dealing out the damage, doing what Kale does. And now Mashmi doing what he does too. Coming up the mid, but Prawly's on the side.
Very close. Prawly not hitting what he wanted to here. Complexity Black reeling from that last game. A very, very close game. And they don't want to suffer the same result here. Curse Academy, though, is definitely putting up a good fight for it to happen again. The third place match here is into the second of the best of five, and Curse Academy riding the wave of a game one win here. Brings it to an early lead 20 minutes into this second game. Sitting at 3-4, so you can see Complexity Black has been able to come up with a few more kills in the fights that Curse has been pushing to get their advantages. But Complexity can't move after those kills. They're kind of stuck in their own means on their side of the map. Now we can see even more backing here. Wards. This is what it looked like last game as well for Curse Academy. Those pink wards all across the map and now offensively on Complexity's side.
Yeah, absolute ward control here for Curse Academy. Like 70% of the map is there.
Yeah.
For Curse Academy. Complexity
yeah,
Black.
Yes.
I know, it's the C names. Ah! Complexity, Curse. Yeah, Curse have ward vision about 70% of the map. The other 30% is on the dragon here for Complexity Black.
Can see just the map kind of tells a story about that. Top half of Curse's jungle is dark. Nobody's
oh, they're
go
waiting for
there.
It. Pro,
this is where the fights are going to be happening, and it's going to be a choose your own adventure depending on what happens. Bubba Dub chooses safety. Chapter 9 backs out. Curse Academy looking to go back to it though. They want to revisit this, and it looks like
oh,
it's going to be the
West
Pink
Rice
Ward.
Is TPing in.
That Pink
turn
Ward
to page
can
35.
Be taken down. What a place. They can't get the five shots in. A great teleport in from West Rice, and he is going to start going hard on this one, using the lamppost to the best of its ability. Robert X Lee coming in with probably from the right side, and Complexity turns the positioning of Curse Academy on top of their own head.
And they end up picking up the smite, so Broken Shard doesn't have to worry about that this time. He's going to pick up this dragon. Save for a miracle.
Boom.
And they get it.
Very good plays. That's exactly what Complexity Black needed to happen. We were saying a little bit that the teleport's going a little underused this game.
Yeah, right on top of the dragon.
They were just waiting.
Oh, yeah.
I love the pink ward, too. Not having enough shots to take it out, because you could see how frantically a few of them hit it right away, and they're like, well, we're in the fight now.
Yeah, 5 HP is a lot. It's about 5 seconds of just one person hitting it.
Yeah.
Most people have like 1.0 attack speed.
Fights don't usually last that.
Yeah.
At least this early. We'll see what both teams can get out of that. Obviously, Complexity feeling very good there. It seems like they're going to go ahead and get the five hits they do need to take out that pink ward. See some of the items coming out here in the inventory. West Rice rocking out a Triforce. Got that build for himself. Regular builds coming in through the jungle. Pretty quick Aegis, actually,
yeah.
For Pat with his Sightstone coming in. He's kind of just old utility descent.
He did that last game too, is where he built up an early Aegis and then turned that into a locket. And Robert is having a much better game than he did last time.
Yeah.
2-0-3. He could still go 2-7, but at this point in the game, don't think that's going to happen. He's off to a great start. He's got his first item down. He's got the Sheen, and then he immediately goes for a pickaxe. So instead of completing the Trinity Force, he's going to stack on some Last Whisper damage here so that he can get through the armor that's being stacked by Rux. And he knows that Pat's going to do it too because he did it last game.
Yeah, it didn't come to the complete value that I thought it would with both AD carries carrying the game. But I like the fact that they both went super hardcore damage until they had to build something because they were getting zeroed out with those Guardian Angels not on. We'll see if it happens again. Like you said, it looks like it. Just pure damage to start it off. Probably not finding really what he wants here. Even with the blue buff, he's able to waste that out onto Rux in the bottom lane and have almost no mana. Rux is a pretty big boy right now. He's got another Giant's Belt for that Randuin's on top of his Sunfire Cape. So he's kind of negating any burst damage that would hit him at the moment without having to have that magic resist.
Yeah, West Price is split pushing despite not having TP up. And there's the Binding landing. Well, there's a hook onto Robert.
Intervention went down. Pat took a lot of damage out of that. So this is all damage that's going to stick now. Dual Set cannot heal K1 Pro or give him that speed.
He's got
up.
The red.
Oh, no. It's clicking. There's the Ardent Blaze. They are going to be able to pick up the kill onto that one. It looks like they may get a very nice pinch in. Mashmi needs to have that peel for Rux coming in.
Oh, they're coming all around him right now.
Sorry, Rux needs to have that peel for
Mashmi. There's a surprise.
Not going to happen. Nobody's peeling for nobody. No caliber nets or swinging. But they are going to say, Rux, you're going to leave Mash to die, but you're going to go push mid.
Now, Duo Second Rux are here. No inside track for Complexity Black just yet. They're going to actually pings the Baron. So they might head straight there. Pat is up, so the smite is available. Yep. Mashby's the only person off the field. This is risky.
This is a very risky play, especially with the two pink wards being down. They're just saying we need to clear it because that's 10 hits they need to go through, and that would be enough time for a little bit of chaos for Curse to create. Robert actually safely farming here. Dodging out a nice hook. Ooh.
Look at that chunk that Prawly took too on his way back. Just yeah. Duosec handing him one for the trip.
You're not going to get out clean, that's for sure.
All that ward control is now in favor of Complexity Black. Pink wards all throughout that Baron pit area.
Yep.
Leave nothing at the dragon. You got one or two. It's not up for a very long time. Pink ward will still sit.
Super textbook. Keep it clean.
But now that those 3 minutes, Curse Academy's wards all throughout the jungle have expired.
Yeah.
Flipped over now. Gold, only 900 in favor of Complexity Black, just neck and neck all game long. Nobody can get an advantage over the other. This is basically game one over again, save for a hyper carry.
Kind of like, so Dragon's good to go for, but it's almost not slowing the game down. But we saw Curse have all those wards in the top half of the jungle, pushing on the second tier turret, and then the inhibitor. But Dragon came up, and then everybody was so dead after it that nobody could push anything. And now Complexity Black, they have found the vision control on the map.
Oh, stopping him from getting the lantern. They're locking him up.
Oh, no, sir. You will not take the lantern and pass go. And it will be Robert X. Lee giving everybody a calling to the face here as they start to push the mid turret. Complexity coming up very big on their own without even a dragon to pressure. Taking out Pat at Wolves, are able to grab the second tier turret and answer back now, giving themselves a 3,000 gold lead, something we did not see last game until 45 minutes in.
And the stacking of CC there to keep Pat locked up was perfect. The dark binding into the root, into the cocoon, just back to back. And now they're trying to go after Robert.
Oh dear. They ran straight for Baron, but were
they can't get to him.
Absolutely looking for a fight. Living for just a few more seconds. Broken Shard also goes down, so they lose one on each side.
Mashmi's exhausted.
Soul Shackle's able to lock down K1 Pro. Mashmi getting the intervention, but he walks straight into the rest of the fight, trying to get the kill for himself.
Westrice has the dueling power.
This is going to be big. Westrice throwing down the lamp power, probably on the backside.
Oh, here's Pat.
Oh my
He's
God,
back.
Pat coming in from nowhere. He is not going to be able to hit the right minion. It's going to have to be a flash attack. No, he has the ward necessary from his Sightstone pickup. Gets the Dragon Rage kicked down, and now he's on the chase with the Magician just missing off on the Sonic Wave. Gonna have another ward right quick, but I don't think he will be in range for the Tipple, or the Tipple, the Tempest Cripple.
The Tipple, yeah, the just tipple. Combine them both. But here's Robert back. He's pulling a Pat on Pat.
Too bad, so sad. Trying to get the kill for himself, goes down. And like I said, these fights are kind of going coast to coast.
Back and forth here. Robert actually eats the ace in the hole very early on and gets low. And then Rux decides, I'm going to face check this. Pops his Dominus to try and get to him. Gets him out of the fight. But then at the bottom, after Rux gets taken out, Broken Sharp's eating a lot of damage that entire time. Mashmi, he's just off on the side. He gets exhausted, but he gets out of the tether. And then he tries to turn it around. He gets the intervention, and that's enough for him to get onto Robert Exley. And now, here's the Baron from Complexity Black. Pat's down. There's no smite for them.
Rux just walks on in. They're not going to be able to grab that with the smite. Pat not in range. And it looks like it's going to be Complexity Black with a lot of stats here, trying to push the advantage of Baron. Spider's going to be taken out. Not able to help on that one. Broken Shard couldn't get close enough for the cocoon.
The flay backwards by K1 Pro that kept him out.
Very big. 12-6 here. Complexity Black really starting to make moves. They're able to pepper these turrets as well as crush down Curse Academy every time. And this is really the first time we've seen a team submit to their own turrets. There has always been a fight, but this is such a lead that Complexity Black knows what they can push and with how much.
There's a really safe Baron there too. Pat was dead, no smite available. They pick it up with some contest from Curse Academy. but Complexity Black were in good shape. Pick it up for themselves. 3K gold advantage now that the dragon has gone over to Cursed Academy. Evening that up just a little bit.
Yeah.
Trying to get back to that even spot, but the kills. These team fights, back to back, been going in Complexity Black's favor.
It's been such a game of controlling objectives. You see where the waves are right now. There were gigantic waves crushing into Complexity Black's base. Now able to clean up. It's almost like here's a cherry on top of everything you just got. You can soak this up. Their control over the game has really left them to lose out on nothing. They've been able to pick up all the resources with the amount of focus they put over towards Cursed Academy, and we see how much it's proving to be in their favor this game. A much better game overall. Same somewhat start. We didn't have the 2v1, but we had the dual lanes going topside, and that kind of left Ruxin, West Rice to be 1v1ing each other a little bit more because of dragon pressure to come up.
Yeah, and last game, it was MashMe who had the edge over Robert X Lee. Now it's completely inversed. 5-0-4 for Robert.
Right,
they can't
get
to him.
Yeah.
MashMe on Caitlyn, 2-3-1. He's getting shut down fairly easily right now. And they're putting a lot on the shoulders of K1 Pro as the support. He has the best score on his team right now. Duosec, he's trying to come up big, but he's paling in comparison to the 2-1-7 that Prawly has. Top lane's winning. Mid lane's winning. Bottom lane is winning for Complexity Black. CS kills everything across the board. And also the fact they have a Talisman of Ascension, they have the go power now. Whereas K1 Pro,
right,
lacking that item, is fine with just the disengage or the engagement of Rux and Pack.
Yeah, the Mikhail's Crucible, definitely there for Mash. A little bit more help. So much crowd control that he can find with the gap closers. Robert X Lee very close. The Black Shield, however, turning the tide of that fight very fast. And the damage actually goes on to Cursed Academy. Only a little bit taken by Robert X Lee that he is more than happy to soak back up off the minions. Ooh,
so a lot of these Black Shields are a little late. But I'm thinking about it now, and it could possibly be a bait by Bubba Dub.
Right, that almost looked like a coordinated
that one looked
kind
like
of oopsie.
That one looked like
if you will.
A lot of the other ones, I'm not so sure about. Or maybe he's going for the bait. It's just a very risky play if you do, because the person can get blown up with physical damage that'll go through the shield.
Right. Well, I don't know how coordinated it was. Seeing that Robert X,
it looked good,
flashes down, makes it a little bit scarier. Maybe with that up, they'll try once again. But the Black Shield is down. Pink wards, you can just see on the outside, so Complexity Black can keep themselves safe. There's a 1-2, not much going down.
West Rice is getting one'd.
Forces the flash out of him, but it looks like, this could be bad for West Rice. He should not make it out of this. The rest of the team is actually going to help and get on this one. A few more shots. Duosec says, heck no, you are not making it out alive. They are not able to turn around for damage either. The focus from Complexity Black quickly goes on to Duosec, but what for? Can they still kill the rest of Cursed Academy? Broken Shard gets hooked out on the side. The Peacemaker hits. He's still alive.
He's out of there.
He flashes into the cocoon. An amazing save that Broken Shard sets up for himself with the rest of the team on the backside as the cavalry. And they continue now to reposition and jockey for the aggression right in front of the base of Cursed Academy. Probably taking a little long way around on that one. And Pat does not go with the Lee Syndrome.
If he did, he may have come up with something.
Maybe.
Didn't have the
damage available
to him,
though. That was a
pretty
split
team. Yeah. It's possible, but you can never know. If you don't know where they are, you have to assume they're everywhere. Now watch this. West Rice is 1v1ing Rux. He's fine with it. He flashes, but he doesn't have Leap Strike for another second. And Pat comes in, kicks him back. He leaps over the box, but he gets hit by the wall, gets Mikhail, so it's not going to slow him. Then Duosec says, I have to get this. We put too much into him. He puts the invulnerability on himself, but boom, here comes Prawly with the burst. DFG, bam, he's out of there. Broken Shard actually juked our cameraman on the first part here. He goes up, back to the minion wave, then he flashes into K1 Pro's hook. It was a good lineup there by K1, but the flash in, no auto attack, he's stunned up. Just the disengage is too strong.
The millisecond.
Yeah, could have just had an auto and would have completed.
Whoa.
3v1, West Rice, go.
West Rice loving it, going for broke on this one. Knowing the team is real close. Oh,
it's a lot of damage.
Nice little two-man kick there. Pat coming up with the disengage. But you look at Complexity Black, they are just ravaging the jungle right now. A mid lane to push. So even with all this crazy aggression going on, now the minions are in their favor. Everything is going to start tacking on to Cursed Academy. And they're going to have to decide what to multitask first. Where is that first priority?
Right now, it looks like it's just going to be try to get the dragons, hold off for a minute. Baron will be up too. So going back and forth, you're just going to have to see what they go for, because both objectives will be up at the same time.
Well, right now, Complexity Black with the count. Four regular, two vision, just around the Baron area. Hashtag no fog. Working with that. So we'll see what they can utilize.
We're going to have to see when the dragon's up in 28 seconds, who goes for it. The vision is Baron. As in B-A-R-R-E-N. I was like, that
the vision is not there.
The vision is Baron.
No, but it is.
It could be both.
5,000 gold lead. Complexity Black has been able to stretch this very confidently. It hasn't been really a slow increase in gold. Once they had it, they've been able to stretch it. It has not wavered back in the favor of Curse Academy. Curse definitely showing a bit of a struggle when they've been behind in the game. The early part of last game is kind of where they figured out we need to take advantage now, and then they held it. When they can't hold it in the game, we get this result right now. Complexity Black has, since 25 minutes, been on this side of the map and in Curse's face.
And we see Westrise has teleport available to him. The Baron is being started up right now, and they have both Bubba Dub and Trolley on zone duty. They're two-manning this.
There's a shot. Something we haven't seen quite too often within this game is those ace in the holes to Prolly. People trying to give that LeBlanc a bit of damage.
They're going to get it before some
sustain
damage.
It. Yeah. All right. There's the stats once again. Curse Academy not able to control the Baron this time. Ooh. Complexity is going to be the one with that duty. Now to push down the mid lane, it's going to be Westrise giving a little bit of harass down to the bottom, but it's Rux that always has to be there, which means the teleport can always come in to surprise the fight.
And Rux has to keep tabs on Westrise. Wherever he goes, he has to answer.
Yep.
Or he has to engage the fight before Westrise gets there and blow somebody up.
Intervention being scared out of Duosec. Already ultimates being used in defense.
And now Dragon's up, but they want to pressure this mid lane. And we saw it earlier, Westrise can 1v1 Rux underneath a turret.
Ooh. Just the quick shots.
It's because he hasn't built any magic resistance.
No.
The Empower is just going to smack him for a lot alongside the Leap Strike and his Grandmaster.
Actually going up quite a bit of ability power to just be grabbing up that Negatron Cloak now. You can see a level 17 Westrise, not too worried about the 14s, 15s, and 16s in front of him. He's even going to give him something what for before he backs off a little bit. The Pink Ward still hold outside of the base. Complexity Black looking to come up very strong here in game
two. Oh, he's going to do a sec.
That, no intervention there. Probably just wore that off, and he's going to go back for a second treatment. The turret goes down. Complexity Black putting up a very good fight in this game and definitely making a name for themselves. Pat gets caught up. Will they be able to finish him off? The 1-2-3 from the rest of the team as everybody gets a piece of that one. We're 36 minutes in on this one. It looks like whatever time Complexity had in between games was just enough to work out what they needed for a win.
And just coming over the wall from Prolly, doing as much damage as he can, going back, then doing it again. Because the cooldown on Mimic is lower than Intervention, he'll be able to burst between them and have it be unnegated damage. So Duosec was no longer available to defend the turret or clear the waves. Now, we're after this bottom one in Rux.
Pure control being shown right now by Complexity. We just saw Robert take a few turret shots. Curse can't even really get themselves to get an advantage off of that.
Oh, he gets out of it.
Getting the heal, getting everything. The Mikhail's Crucible and getting a summoner heal from Robert X. Lee. CLB keeps himself alive to fight another day and to possibly take another inhibitor.
It's a new patch, and Jat always talked about how there's so many heals now. There's so many shields in the game that when you think you have somebody, you really don't. Mikhail's comes in, it's like, oh, there's 300 HP to you. Here's heal.
There's a locket.
500 HP. Just ridiculous amounts to save somebody. That wasn't there before, so you have to have that adjustment period.
Yep. Absolutely. Curse Academy now trying to clean out a bit of their jungle, gain back what is rightfully theirs. And right now they're doing a good job at least getting the minions pushed out. It's going to be work for Complexity Black to get themselves back to the front door. So a little bit of time Curse buys for themselves. Not too many items are really going to come into play here. It's going to have to be a catch on Robert. Maybe something, maybe like you said, one of the, not misses on the Black Shield, but if they can get in between that timing where Bubba Dub has missed a few, and you're going to be able to rock it and lock it down. 319 to 296, 240 to 203 in the mid lane, and the AD carries was just previously, so we're definitely getting up there in CS almost to the full items as we were last game. Still got a few to go for each inventory.
Yeah, and Robert's really close. He's 605, highest CS in the game, most kill participation, and he's just rocking it right now. Complete turnaround from last game where he had the most deaths on his team and in the game by a long shot.
Ashmi again going for orb as well.
Yeah, he wants that vision. That's usually how he does things. It also helps on Caitlyn because you can always ace in the hole somebody if you don't have vision of them anyway.
That is super great.
Set yourself up for it, yeah, if they get out.
Nope.
Also, they need this vision that can't be swept out on the side because they are on their back foot. And now, once again, they're trying to do this game, trying to get this inhibitor.
Yeah, these are also going to go down very fast. Mashmi, 90 caliber net too. I wouldn't call it safety, but he's alive for now.
Westrice, once again, he's going to be dueling Rux in that top lane. Just split pushing, it's that imminent threat, and here goes this inhibitor.
And it's so strong as well. You got a Triforce on both sides, Irene. So once Westrice does get to that, they're taking it down just as fast as these guys in the bottom lane. Westrice, a little back and forth, hasn't done too much damage to Rux, if any. But the team will start to rotate. They're going to start taking down everything and anything before they win this second game. Calling coming out, giving everybody a little bit of breathing room and making sure Mashley can't heal up too much HP, but he's got the Bloodthirster. It's no worry for him, and he's got super minions to get that HP back from. Getting close, Irene. One last engage. If Curse Academy can find a good in, what are they looking for?
They're looking for an engagement. They're looking, like you said, to get between the Black Shield with a hook and start the fight off and possibly have Duosec blow somebody up and use his intervention on the target that is being focused down by LeBlanc. That'll be their key in. It's going to have to be a very close play because Westrice is not with the team. He's never going to be with the team. He's going to keep split pushing until there's a great opening for him to do so. And he can just duel Rux one-on-one. So there's that imminent threat. So they have to win a four-on-four without Rux.
Remember coming into this game, Curse Academy playing a very similar composition to game one. The only change here is from Twitch to Caitlyn. And it doesn't seem like the composition is working out as well. That pressure that Twitch put on the fight with the intervention, there it is being used on to Duosec. Just not coming together as rich as it did last time.
Gone.
Another kill coming in. Robert X. Lee having a very good game for himself. A double kill to pick up the Ender on that one. And they are going to keep going for
the
long haul here. Complexity Black.
It's going for another.
Will not let a second game go. They're going to bring it back. The quadra kill coming in for Robert X. Lee on the Lucian pickup this game. And he is going to help carry the team to victory here. Very definitive win compared to our first game as Complexity Black brings it to game three, 1-1 now.
Oh, they got him!
Academy.
Very nice.
Pentakill after the elongated time. You can hear the chat blips going out. GG, great Penta. Robert X. Lee in the third place matchup, helping carry the team to victory.
11-0-5, complete turnaround from his performance in the previous game where he had the most deaths, getting a pentakill in the end there, basically handed it to him there by the 90 caliber
net
into the Elise. Wrapped in a cocoon for him on that one.
No butterfly from this one.